Good morning. My name is Richard Meredith. I'm the head of Arable Knowledge Exchange. Welcome to this session for the Agronomy Week 2020. As the environment climbs on the agenda for farming, so does it for the priorities of AHDB. And today we're joined by John Foote, who's the head of the AHDB environment team. John joined us at the end of October 2019, and he joined us from EDF Energy. As we've all had a bizarre year, as you all know, John's also been tasked with writing the new AHDB environment strategy, and that'll be talking about how we are achieving net zero carbon farming for agriculture. John, thank you very much for joining us, and I think I'm going to hand over to you at this stage to walk us through how achieving net zero, what it means to you.
Thank you very much for the introduction, Richard. And it's really great to be back here a year after I started with AHDB. So I thought it would be useful just to remind everybody why we're moving towards net zero and overall trying to improve environmental performance across the UK. And there's a lot of policy that has been pushed by the UK government that it wants to achieve net zero by 2050. That's linked to the Paris Agreement. But there's also the environment strategy and plan. And in fact, 2 days ago, the government published an update, which was a 10-point plan, which promised 30,000 hectares of trees to be planted per annum, and also trailed the new environmental land management scheme, which will replace many of the sort of current payments across the UK, but in particular England. The NFU in 2019 published its achieving net zero goals, and that was a really good sort of kickstart to the whole process to think about where we as an industry are going. And we've seen in recent months the Environment Bill and the Agriculture Bill being published, and they set, you know, binding targets in terms of agricultural productivity, payment schemes, and in you know, England in particular, means to control air pollution, waste, biodiversity. The government overall want to try and leave the environment in a better state than it is now for future generations, and I think that's something we would all agree with. So where is farming versus sort of other sectors in the UK? Well, greenhouse gases have reduced since the early 1990s when they peaked. But unfortunately, what we've seen is, you know, significant reductions in the sort of early 2000s. And then the emissions have largely flatlined of late as it's become more difficult and more expensive to make changes. And 88% of ammonia emissions, which is a pollutant that can damage biodiversity and also has an impact on human health, that, you know, 88% of those emissions come from agriculture, from manure management, and the use of sort of fertilizers. And the main sort of greenhouse gases are methane, nitrous oxide, again, from emissions from soil, from fertilizer application, and carbon dioxide, which is from direct burning of fuel. Now, that's important because what we see is that other sectors such as transport and energy have reduced. And as Richard said, I came from the energy sector, where historically emissions were 75% of UK PLC, and they've now dropped down to, you know, broadly a quarter. And we'll see those numbers drop significantly over the next few years, both in terms of energy and transport as we move to greener forms of energy. And as the government announced this week, we move to electric cars and vans by 2030. So agriculture actually is going to, whilst it's only 10% at the moment, its slice of the pie will get worse with time. And that's another reason why we have to take action, along with, you know, meeting consumer expectations. And increasingly, investors, the supply chain, and the consumer are asking, what are we doing to reduce our impact on the environment? So we need to think about how we can move forwards as a sector and drive that improvement in the sector. So to that aim, we've developed our overarching goal, which is to improve the impact of agriculture on air, water, and soil. So we're looking at the total environment and not just carbon. And that's really important because if we start looking at just carbon on its own, generally it's not a good proxy for environmental performance, but also UK agriculture may not look so good against other sort of products. And I'll use a dairy example, which I know maybe is not applicable to sort of agronomists, but if you're comparing a pint of milk with a non-dairy alternative, and you just look at carbon, it will look worse. But when you start looking at the total environmental impacts, such as water availability, impacts on biodiversity, as well as carbon, then that pint of milk starts to look pretty good compared to almond milk produced in California, for example. So even for sort of arable crops, we need to look at that total environmental impact and make that assessment. We also want to make sure that we enhance biodiversity on our land, and we also enhance farm incomes, and we provide sustainable incomes for farmers. And we look at the total global environment. And this is where opportunities with crops such as either trying to grow soya here with, you know, varieties that will grow well in the UK climate. And we saw that, you know, maybe 30 years ago, maize only could be grown in the south of the country, but now we can grow it pretty much anywhere. But, you know, can we grow other sort of protein based crops that would displace soya, which has issues in terms of the consumer's mind and actual issues in terms of impacts on rainforests and land use change in other countries? So it's looking at that total environment so we don't push UK exports abroad. We also want to be the trusted source of information and support farmers, as I said, to sort of deliver that sustainable farm income. So we're looking at, you know, when we drill down below that overall goal, we're looking at helping farming decarbonize and become a net store for carbon. And we see a significant opportunity for that. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that every farm will achieve net zero or every agricultural sector will achieve net zero, because some can do more than others. But overall, the sector will become net zero by the government's targets by 2050. Ideally, if we can do it by 2040, that gives us the opportunity to provide offsets for the rest of the UK economy. We need to reduce diffuse pollution from agriculture, as I've explained. You know, we're the major source of ammonia, and we also need to make sure that we use fertilizers and think about how we apply those more efficiently. And like many products that are used that have high carbon inputs, they also tend to be high cost. So if we can displace the use of those inorganic fertilizers with more naturally occurring manures, incorporate those into soils, and also use things such as cover crops to sort of build nitrogen, build soil carbon, and build resilience in the soils, it will also help us to improve the soil health and improve the sustainable use of our soils. We also want to promote productive, sustainable agriculture. We want to connect up ecosystems, and we want to make sure that we maximize the use of the products we have, reduce wastage, and provide information through to the consumer in that piece. So how are we going to do that? Well, we're looking at three levels of entry. So we're looking at, you know, for most farmers, being able to use some simple KPIs, which they can then use to drive day-to-day productivity. We're also looking at rolling out farm excellence platform carbon audits. So we've got our monitor and strategic farms that are dotted around the country. We have 100 of those farms. And what we want to be able to do is support farmers to start using carbon auditing tools, and then start to understand where they can reduce their carbon inputs, start to look for savings, and to improve their performance. And from that work, we should then be able to feed back to the KPIs, because we're able to validate that those KPIs that we've got that help all farmers to drive improvements in productivity and reduce carbon and move towards net zero and overall environmental impact are working. We're also looking at developing a sort of benchmarking tool, and this is just the working title of it, but it will look to link up to the UK National Atmospheric Inventory. But more importantly, what it will do is enable a farmer and a grower to start looking at, you know, where does carbon and nitrogen sort of trade-offs start to occur? Because unfortunately, you generally find that if you try and reduce nitrogen, carbon goes up and vice versa. So it's just looking at where those trade-offs are on the farm. And again, linking back to, you know, the KPIs and level two. But we also recognise that we can't just have these tools and systems and support without maybe explaining how you can get to net zero. So what we're doing at the moment is developing a pilot, and we're looking to sort of launch that spring next year, and then to seek feedback. So this is very much a sort of pilot project around the evidence for farming and around net zero. And what we want to do with that is build something that's based on a What Works Centre. And What Works Centres all tend to work in the same way using the model that's on the screen at the moment. The one that you will have heard of is NICE, which will decide whether or not you get your COVID vaccine and which COVID vaccine works and is cost effective. Now, we're not looking at making those life and death decisions, but what we are looking as to do is look at where we've got research that supports the industry, and we can look at both the current research and grey literature and look at what's coming up in the future, and then really boil that evidence down into a series of simple to access templates, and provide some commentary that agronomists, farmers, growers can all access. We also want to link in partnership with others, such as ADAS's Yen Net Zero Network, Rothamsted, other sort of scientific groups, for example, to sort of pull field trial work in and use our own strategic and monitor farms also to pull in those field trials and almost validate what we've got in terms of evidence and the sort of translated information that we're going to provide to farmers and growers to sort of say this has been tried and tested. Now, the advantage of the What Works type model is that not only can it help farmers, growers, and agronomists to, you know, use the latest information practices to make, you know, better decisions, but we can also then use it to sort of identify where we've got gaps in the research base and then use that to better target levy payers' money and, you know, leverage far more value for that money than maybe we can currently do so. We can also use it to sort of inform the development of things like the Environmental Land Management Scheme and other sort of new policies that may come from government and use that as the evidence base to support, feedback in that space. So what does it look like? And this is just a mock-up of the sort of pilot, and what it shows is that you've got a number of practices, and then what we do is we clearly articulate what the outcomes are, and we give an indication of cost, whether or not it's effective, and the strength of evidence based on the research that's there. Now, the idea is that, you know, I almost call this TripAdvisor for farming and growing, in that there will be some filters in the sort of pilot version that we'll launch in April. So you can almost select how much money you're willing to spend, look for maybe the outcomes that you're trying to deliver, and then you sort of would get this sort of table that gets to that information quickly. And again, we're going to be very clear where things don't work or where the evidence is less brilliant. And, you know, that will then, again, support that decision-making process. What will then happen is you'll see down below, rather maybe too small, we've got some text that says, you know, what is the practice? How effective is it? And there will be some very short text that supports the information in the table that then gives you a guide as to how you can go about doing this, where some of the pitfalls sit, and where you can seek further information. And this will link through to the Institute of Agriculture and Horticulture that we're developing in conjunction with others. And that will then provide training materials, courses, et cetera, if they're required. We're also looking at the approach of having a decision tree that maybe helps guide you through this process and brings you again back to the sort of practices and the outcomes that you may want to look at. And the reason why we're looking at that decision tree is maybe an approach, and the version that's on screen at the moment is a little bit American, but it sort of may help, you know, prioritize where you put your effort before you start moving down the list of options. And therefore, you can deliver those that will make the biggest difference before you get to the sort of more expensive, more technical, slower to deliver type options. So we'll be keen to sort of understand your views on this. And there's a short questionnaire that's coming up where we can get a little bit of feedback from you, and we'd appreciate that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, John. It's great to see something so ambitious for our industry. And like John mentioned there, the environment strategy here sits within the wider AHDB strategy, and that's going out to consultation to the industry this winter. And as users of AHDB, it's your opportunity to feed in and direct what the levy organisation does for our industry. Like John said, you can begin this feedback by completing the survey, which automatically comes up at the end of this session. So thank you very much, John, and thank you very much for joining us. We hope you enjoy Agronomy Week 2020. Goodbye.